Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is John Green.
And I'm Peter Harbison.
We're members of Glasnevin Trust, which operates and owns Glasnevin Museum, which won the Kenneth Hudson Award in 2012. Glasnevin Trust operates five cemeteries, two crematoria, and monument works and a forest. Time is of the essence, but it would be wrong of me, on behalf of the Trust, not to thank Tomislav and Luca, the team, the technicians in particular, all the participants and the moderators for making this such an interesting and fascinating weekend. But I want you to get into our mindset, because we have only operated a museum since 2010. So with your permission, Hannah, I'd like the lights to come up, just for a very short time. Put up the lights in the house up, please. And to ask you, if I can have the lights up.
Can the lights go up?
I could ask you one very simple question. When you drop off this your mortal perch, or bluntly, when you die, what would you like to do? We only have a menu of two options, cremation or burial. So those of you who would like to be cremated, please raise your hands. And those of you who would like to be buried, please raise your hands. It's interesting, that is about 90%, 10% cremation. In Ireland, it's exactly the opposite. Now that I have you thinking of our mindset, imagine in 6 years' time, from 2012, we win the Kenneth Hudson Award. The citation of the Kenneth Hudson Award talks about being the most unusual, the most daring, and perhaps the most contentious. But importantly, it is the museum which challenges the common perceptions of the role of museum in society. This year's winner was the Community Museum in Battaglia, and it calls itself the Museum for Everyone. And I noticed that the Magritte Museum said the same thing. We were founded, our cemeteries are founded on the concept of being for peoples of all religions and none. So perhaps we have something in common that you wouldn't expect. In other places, I would say we were unique, but in this august company, I would say we're different. Why did we win the award? Well, I'm certain we didn't win it because we built a magnificent building and we filled it full of interesting content. I think we won it because we integrated it into a working cemetery. But not just a working cemetery, a cemetery that is hugely significant in Irish terms. It is significant because of the way it was founded, and because of the people that are buried there. A brief history lesson. We're going back 400 years to the penal laws, 1607, Nick, not early 17th century. Penal laws were introduced into Ireland. But as many of you will know, this was a crazy century. European religious turmoil. The Pope opposite the Holy Roman Emperor. And to bring it home, in Ireland, Catholic landlords supporting a Protestant king. These were the main players. There was James I who introduced the laws into Ireland, which was unexpected because we thought he'd be on our side. Then Cromwell came over. He wreaked havoc. He certainly wasn't. Charles I restored the monarchy, but his line didn't last very long. And the Hanoverians were parachuted in to maintain the monarchy in England. And of course, that led to the cementing of penal laws, certainly in Ireland. And it was the grandson and great-grandson, George III, or as Vim said to me, George III and George IV, that Daniel O'Connell had to deal with when he strode onto the world stage. And I say world stage not lightly, because O'Connell became a world figure in a time when we didn't have internet, we didn't have television, we didn't have radio, we didn't have telephone, and yet he was known throughout the world. O'Connell founded the Catholic Association, which was the first mass movement, membership movement. Membership's the key thing, because membership brings commitment and ownership. He had a two-tier subscription movement. If you were rich, you paid 2 shillings. If you were poor, you paid a penny a month. It was collected at the church gate. So instantly, he had a network with which he could disseminate his information, and with which he could organize his meetings. His meetings were huge, but they were always peaceful. This scared the living daylights out of the government and was the key reason why Catholic emancipation was achieved. I've put up this slide here with Obama and Frederick Douglass. It may seem a bit far-fetched, but I certainly see a parallel in the way that Obama organized his internet collection. Lots of money from lots of small money from different people on the internet to O'Connell's penny a month. But in addition to that, in his inauguration speech, his hero, Obama's hero, was Frederick Douglass. Douglass was a black slave who was bought out of slavery, wrote the narratives, and then came to Ireland to meet O'Connell. He was a sort of subservient freed slave until he met O'Connell. O'Connell, in fact, introduced him as the Black O'Connell. Douglass went back to America, became Abraham Lincoln's slavery advisor, persuaded him not to send slaves back to Africa, and the rest is history, the Civil War. And in his inauguration speech, Obama talks of his hero, Douglass, and when he came to Dublin, he talked about the huge influence that O'Connell had on Frederick Douglass. But when O'Connell was fighting for emancipation, one of the most difficult penal laws was that which prevented Catholics from having Catholic burial rights at the graveside. And he set about founding cemeteries. When he founded these cemeteries, which are still in our care, he decreed that they should be for peoples of all religions and none. Doesn't sound very mad at this time, but if you go around Europe and look at graveyards at that time, they're segregated graveyards. This is a huge influence on our cemetery. As a result of this, we have a panoply of religions. But why was it significant? It was significant because it was in the midst of the most vitriolic debate. Go and read Hansard and see what Robert Peel, who was the leader of the House, see what Wellesley, Arthur Wellesley, known as the Duke of Wellington, a fellow Irishman, were saying about him. And of course, George IV, who was a pathological hater of Catholics, who up until the day before he signed the bill, said there will never be Catholic emancipation in my life. Nowhere can you touch Irish history to the same degree as in Glasnevin Cemetery, consequent to Daniel O'Connell's decision. We have, as I said, a cast of thousands of important people. Most famously, these two gentlemen, Eamon de Valera and Michael Collins, leaders and brothers in arms in the War of Independence. Unfortunately, leaders and hated archenemies in the subsequent Civil War. And believe me, these two gentlemen can still split families today. We were set up as a Victorian Garden Cemetery, and at the same time, there were the Magnificent Seven cemeteries opened in London. All of them, bar one, has failed. We didn't fail because we extended our cemeteries, we bought new cemeteries. But there was a fundamental flaw in the way that cemeteries were designed. You took in your money at the beginning, and you didn't think about 100 years, let alone 180 years later. You have the problems of drainage, trees growing up through graves, etc. So we ended up not like this. That was what the Victorians expected. And at the turn of the 19th century into the 20th century, you'd come with your pram and your family and visit the graves, and the wealthy vaults were opened, and they were like little shrines you could go and visit. Unfortunately, we're a working cemetery, 49 hectares, 200,000 headstones, 1.5 million burials, 2,000 funerals, and without any museum or anything, we have maybe 250,000 people visiting every year. And that was our dilemma.
Good, and this is where I take it from John. We certainly had a dilemma. After all, if you look at the opening of the new millennium, the cemetery had been going for about 180 years, and we didn't really have very much money. And the cemetery was slowly but surely, showing the neglect that there was all around the place. John mentioned some of the London cemeteries, and one of the London cemeteries came along and had a look at us and said, really, you should be closing down. But we said, no, absolutely no way are we going to be closing down. And we then did a survey as to how much it would cost. cost to actually go and, you know, refurbish the cemetery. And we came up with the sad number of 200 million euro. And we said, good heavens, now, we're a voluntary body and a charitable body. And we said, there's no way in which we're going to be able to come up with that amount of money. But nevertheless, we did go and approach the government. And very humbly, we only asked for 85,000. 85 million. And then Tomislav mentioned on Thursday evening that what you really need is luck. And we were steeped in luck, in the sense that our cemetery was in the political constituency of our Prime Minister at the time, Bertie Ahern. And his parents and one brother were actually buried in the cemetery, so we had him very much on our side. And so we invited him to the cemetery, and you can see him there. I better get out of the way a little bit so that some of you can see him better. He's in the centre of the picture there, and John will show you with the little red thing where he is. And a lot of the other people that you see around the place, this is our committee, our voluntary body, which in fact runs the cemetery, and as you will see, it actually also runs the museum as well. It's a body which is made up of all sorts of I wouldn't say curious people. I mean, you've got a lady doctor, you've got a lawyer, you've got a priest, you've got an engineer, you've got a banker, you've got businessmen, and you even have an archaeologist, come art historian such as myself. So you can see that we're a very unusual kind of bunch of people. We as I say, are the committee. But nevertheless, when Bertie Ahern finally came along and said, okay, we'll give you 25 million spread over a number of years, but that was specifically for refurbishing the cemetery. But at the same time, we kind of made a half a promise that we would also build a museum, but out of our own resources, out of our own money, not any government money at all. And this, of course, set our minds thinking about a museum. What should the content be of a museum, which is, part of a cemetery? What should its, we need an architectural competition, because, in fact, the older buildings, which you'll see in a moment, there were two older buildings there which really were totally unsuitable for a museum. So we would obviously have to have an architectural competition. And then the question came up, okay, here, a cemetery in the, a museum in the cemetery, what in heaven's name should a museum in a cemetery be about? There's scarcely any other cemetery anywhere in the whole world practically that has a cemetery museum. So I mean, it sounded like a strange context, concept. So anyway, we started thinking about the actual purpose, but the real purpose behind it was, and here I'll have to give you another little history lesson, which is that as of starting next year, you have a number of things that were happening 100 years ago. You had, for instance, the Great War, World War I, starting in 1914. We in Dublin had a rebellion, which the results of which, in fact, had a very formative role in the development of the modern Irish state. And then John also mentioned a civil war, which is a terrible, bloody thing to have to happen to any country. And we had a civil war in the very early 1920s. And there were a lot of people buried in our cemetery who in fact, were the results of deaths in these various different conflicts, be it war, be it rebellion, be it civil war, or whatever. And we felt that given the fact that we had these people who really were involved in a strife of one sort or another, we felt that we were going to be the people, the place which should in fact commemorate the dead of 100 years ago. And we still believe that, or at least we hope, that in fact the government is actually going to say in a year or two's time, yes, we are the place which is actually going to commemorate these people. And this was really the raison d'etre, the thinking behind getting a cemetery museum together. So I mentioned to you an architectural competition. So we had an architectural competition. It was won by a Dublin-based but Polish-born architect, Andrzej Weichert. And he was almost obsessed with light. And what he gave us was a building which had wonderful windows all around the place. So there was really, it was full of light inside. And what he gave us was what I can describe only as an uplifting building. And you can see that it really does lift itself up. And it lifts itself up towards the round tower, which in fact is the burial monument of Daniel O'Connell, who is our founder. And if you look at the, can you go back again just for a second, John? If you look at the upper story there, you can see that, as I say, it's all full of windows, and there's an absolutely wonderful view out over the cemetery from the first floor. And what the building that he gave us has, in fact, three floors. But it starts off down below in the basement, and you go down steps, and you've got inscriptions on the left-hand side, which are taken from some of the gravestones. But it's called the City of the Dead, and this is really reminding us, but also reminding you, the world, that the cemetery was the centerpiece of the so-called Hades chapter. In James Joyce's Ulysses, which is, after all, one of the great novels of the 20th century. And James Joyce's parents are buried in the cemetery. He's buried in Zurich, unfortunately. We didn't get him. But anyway, he brings in the cemetery as being, the centerpiece of the Hades chapter. And we have, in fact, a nice quotation from the Hades chapter in the museum when you go down and look at it. And then you kind of pass along a little bit further, and you see objects which really are associated with the trades and the professions of those who were buried in the cemetery over a century or so. And then you get down to how is a cemetery run, and we've got a kind of a reconstruction of how gravediggers actually dug graves in the days before machines. And then there's a slightly darker side to the gravediggers, because some of them were actually grave robbers. And what fascinates children is the rather gruesome bit of the grave robbers coming along and extracting dead bodies, recently dead bodies, out of the graves in order to go and sell them on to anatomical institutions. But then also, to bring us up to modern times, you have the modern gravediggers, our own gravediggers of today, who are actually telling the story of their own particular experiences, should we say, the ups and the downs in the cemetery. So it's really bringing into things, making things lively. And one of the things I should say that the architect was very good when it came to talking to the local community. I mean, the local community realised that the cemetery, it was their cemetery. So we had to make sure that they were in with us. And the architect was actually extremely good when showing the kind of thing he was going to be doing to their cemetery, and they were absolutely delighted with this. But anyway, to continue on, when you've finished in the basement, you then take a lift and you go upstairs to the top floor, and there you have three things. You've got, if you're interested in trying to find an ancestor who may have been buried in the cemetery within the last century and a half or so, we have a complete record of absolutely everyone, which is on a computer, and you can find out through the genealogical sources. You can find out about your ancestor. Then you've got a temporary exhibition, which at the moment is about Daniel O'Connell, who is the founder of the cemetery. And then you've got something which is out of my field. I'm not one of these techies. I can't, you've all been talking about wonderful technological things in your museum, and we have one, even if I don't understand it myself. It's a thing called the timeline. And this is something which, it's a kind of 10-meter long thing, which tells you the stories of about 250 of the most important people who are buried in the cemetery. It gives you the names, and then you kind of press a button, and then a name comes up, and then you press another button on the same spot, and then you get more details until you've got the whole visual and biographical details of any one of these particular people. And so you're really through it. You're bringing 250 dead to life, if I can use the phrase. And then finally, sandwiched sandwiched in between the top floor and the bottom floor, you've got the ground floor. And when you come into the ground floor, first of all, you've got the shop, which, of course, everyone has in their museum. And then you have the reception area, which is where you can buy your ticket. If you want to go out and get a tour around the cemetery and so on, you can buy your ticket in the reception area. And when you finish with your guided tour, then you can come in and you can have your cup of coffee. And the interesting thing is you can have your coffee not only in the cafeteria, which is part and parcel of the André Weishaupt's building, but you can actually have it outside among the gravestones, or between the museum and the gravestones. It might sound a rather ghoulish concept, but it actually works very well. It's lovely seeing people on a lovely, you know, summer morning out there, you know, sitting, you know, drinking their coffee and eating their buns and so on out in the cemetery. And you say this is really kind of a part of it, because it really makes it into what I might describe as a living cemetery. Now, this all cost us, needless to say, a lot of money, and as I pointed out to you earlier, it was our own money, and I can tell you it cost us 11 million, and we're still paying back the bank to a very considerable extent, but it was worth it. Why? Because if you look at travel advisor, and there was when yesterday the word travel advisor came up, possibly with different spelling, I should say, but travel advisor came up, and we are consistently getting you know, one or other of the three top spots in travel advisor telling people what to go and visit in the city of Dublin. And I think that is a great achievement. So really, summing up what I'm saying, we have come a long way in 6 years. And really, the museum itself has only been going for three. And that is largely thanks to one person who is our own splendid committee chairman, and that is John Green. Because it was his vision, his vigour, and his enthusiasm that got the museum off the ground, that created it, and that brought it to completion. And so it is with the greatest of pleasure that I now hand you back to John Green.
Very quickly, with a huge fanfare. We had amazing coverage, press coverage. The Taoiseach opened it, and we thought we're on the bee's knees here. We very quickly won an award, and we went over to Los Angeles to pick up a Thea, which is the Themed Entertainment Awards. The National Art Museum was there, having spent 150 million. Disney family had spent 120 million. And of course, Harry Potter. They won four awards. We won one. As we were walking out, Mark Woodbury, who was the man who brought Harry Potter from Warner to Universal, was walking out with one of his gongs. And he turned to me and said, "We have a lot in common." And I said, "Well, apart from the fact that you won four times the number of awards and spent 20 times the money, yes, we have a lot in common." But he did say one thing to me. He said, "Tell your story, because nobody else did." And that was a mistake we did. We thought, we've built this magnificent museum, we're getting fantastic reviews, fantastic press, people will come. Now we've learnt the story. I've chose that because that is an award-winning campaign that we had. Bodies are very important in Irish history. Very quickly, when somebody, a Republican, died on the West Coast of America, you trained him back through and raised lots of money stopping at all the things. When he died on the East Coast, you still brought him back to the West Coast before he came back to Ireland. This was a famous speech which took place in Glasnevin Cemetery in 1915, which was the preamble to the Easter Rising. And technology is going to allow me to leave here, I think. How would I start that? Sorry.
Technology again.
So this was our award-winning advert, which changed our attitude.
The fools, the fools, the fools. They have left us our Fenian dead. And while Ireland holds these graves, Ireland unfree shall never be at peace.
Glasnevin Cemetery, 1915. 10,000 people witness Pierce's oration at O'Donovan Ross's graveside. Now hear the words that have echoed for a century, live each day on the same spot. Visit our museum, relax in the cafe, glasnevinmuseum.ie. Glasnevin, all human life is here.
And the outcome is we're in the middle of another, that was a 2012 campaign, we're in the middle of another campaign. I've just got the tweet that we've won another award for that. That's based on things like 1,000 salmons, 400 cods, and 4 hooks. If you think about it, you might get there. our final thoughts are, never open a museum in the midst of a recession. Why? Because it gives you grey hair.